in Mark, he says, how much longer do I have to put up with you? Every time I read that, I say, Jesus, you really hurt my feelings when you say that. Because I think you must say that about me a lot. Mike, how much longer am I have to put up
but with remember, you? It's the intonation, though.
Yeah, intonation is everything.
Okay, we are in our final session with Michael Codd. This actually ended up being so quick. I'm quite depressed that we're ending up at our last session now because I had so much fun. But yeah, this is the Gospel of Wisdom. Identity is Matthew. And we are taking a look at John, the time of writing. Again, don't want to categorize it, otherwise we sound like Greeks. Between 90 to 100 AD, more or less, Jesus as the Son of God. Yeah. The Gospel of Wisdom, hometown. Most probably, Capernaum, we know, is the author's hometown, mm-hmm. John, and the disciple whom Jesus loved. As you mentioned, a very unique book with a poetic, reflective, and often profound tone. The style is markedly different from the others. Can you speak into that a little bit? In what way is it unique?
Well, I think the reason it's unique, it's 92% unique. 92% of John isn't in Matthew, Mark, or Luke. And I think there are a number of reasons. First of all, it's the last gospel to be written. Peter's been dead for 40 years when John writes this gospel. In fact, John will tell us a rumor has started that he's not going to die until Jesus comes back, right? That's in chapter 21. They have to deal with that rumor. And here in America, the guy who used to sing for Billy Graham, George Beverly Shea, George Beverly Shea lived to be 103. And there was a rumor that started that he wasn't going to die until Jesus came back. I said, it's just... same thing as John. It was so, to me, it was so funny.
Circular. Nothing new under the sun, hey?
There's nothing new under the sun. But he's been preaching and teaching these things for 30 or 40 years. That's one reason it's sermonic. Jesus is the bread and the life and the light. And, you know, you can tell John's been preaching these things.
It's elegant.
And it really is. It's elegant. There's a primitiveness about Mark that feels like Mark is writing down Peter's account. And that's because I think that's what we have. Then all these years later, we have the last living disciple. You're sitting at the feet of the last living disciple when you read John. And he's telling you stories that he's been preaching and teaching for, you know, decades.
Yeah.
And that I think that's one reason for the elegance. The other reason, and this is kind of new for me, you know, John and Jesus are first cousins. This John and Jesus, now John, we know John the Baptist and Jesus are related.
Yeah.
But there's this woman, there's among the three, there's this woman who, there's the two Marys who go to the tomb afterwards. But then there's a third woman. I've got my references right here. In Mark, her name is Salome. In Matthew 27, she's the mother of the sons of Zebedee, which makes her John's mother. And then in John 19:25, she is his mother's sister. Now, if this is the same woman, Salome is Mary's sister, and she's John's mom. That makes Jesus and John first cousin, which explains why does Jesus entrust John, his mother, to John from the cross.
John, yeah.
They're cousins. They've grown up together. And he's very young. He's probably 14, 15 years old. So I think he needed Mary as much as Mary needed him.
Sure.
But there's this special closeness they have. And I think you get that another reason why the Gospel of John is so unique. They're cousins. I mean, that's incredible to me.
Yeah. Yeah. That's beautiful. I mean, it just kind of makes sense. It ties things together much more when you consider that. Like you said, he uses many symbolic titles for Jesus, such as Lamb of God, the Resurrection, the Vine. Jesus also uses the phrases in the Gospel of John of I am, unmistakably identifying himself with being the eternal Christ, the eternal God.
Yes.
So that also comes through a lot, that he is the eternal King of eternity.
And we refer to that. That's a high Christology. That's what you would expect, right? Yeah. After, you know, this sort of Christological understanding of who Jesus is has grown over the decades. And now we get to John. And the other thing we don't have in John is parables. No parables in John, but Jesus is the parable in John. So Jesus will say, I'm the bread of life, and then he feeds 5,000 people. Or he'll say, I'm the light of the world, and he opens the eyes of a man born blind. And again, see the elegance of that? He understands who Jesus is because he's been meditating and preaching and praying all these decades. And that's one of the uniqueness. It doesn't make John better than Mark.
No.
But it's just part of the difference. It's part of the difference.
Part of the focus. Yeah. I love how he focuses on the character of Christ and those beautiful, like you said, those personal parables of who Jesus refers, who Jesus is for us. And and that to me seems much more personal. Speaking of personal, he also really focuses in on the discussions with Nicodemus, the woman of the at the well. It's a very personal, intimate moment. You've also mentioned that those are things that draw you in and closer to the one-on-one conversations that he has in his gospel.
Only John has long discussions between Jesus and one other person. The other gospels don't do that. And I think there are 11. I think I counted 11. And you mentioned a woman at the well.
Yeah, Nicodemus.
Cana, Nicodemus, right? Raising of Lazarus, the whole discussion between Martha and Mary, that long discussion. That's only in John, which I think is really interesting.
What does that speak to you? What does that tell you?
I think it may be an indication that he's a pastor because he's interested in almost Jesus being pastorally talking to somebody. That's kind of the best shot I can take it at that. But being an insider, he might have been there when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus. Or Nathaniel. I think he certainly was there when Jesus and Nathaniel were talking. But he remembers these people by name and this discussion that they had with Jesus. And I think
it really is a postural aspect of him, isn't it?
It's Jesus talking to people about these issues, and I think that would have meant more to John. I like looking at what he leaves out and what he substitutes. So he leaves out birth narratives, no shepherds, no wise men. But what does he give us? Incarnation, the beginning was the Word.
And the feet washing and those things that also come in that are not mentioned in the other Gospels.
Right. I think he's the first person that could bring himself to tell you that story. I think the other Gospel writers certainly know that story.
I think they were just too embarrassed.
Too humiliating. Jesus should not. Peter's right. Jesus should not have done that. That's what slaves do. And so what does Jesus say to Peter? He says, look, Peter, if you don't get this, you don't get me.
Yeah.
I'm a servant and I want you to be servants. And here's the extreme example. Leaves out the Lord's Supper, substitute the foot washing, leaves out Gethsemane, leaves out the Sermon on the Mountain. On the Mount. It's just really interesting to me, the things he leaves out.
I love that foot washing addition, because to me, it seems like he understands a part of Christ's heart that is so, it's like a revelation to me, really, of the depth of understanding. It's almost like David also, he had a depth of understanding God's heart. And you have those individuals who just, they get something about the nature of God more than others. I think maybe John brings that out in his gospel a lot.
I think so. And he's been a pastor for all these years. He's been washing people's feet for all these years. And that the meaning that he got from being a servant, I, John, a servant of Christ, I, Peter, a servant of Christ, I, Paul, and the word they use is a word for slave. I, John, a slave of Christ. That was their identity. That's the identity Jesus gave them.
Why does he refer to himself as the one who Jesus loved? I know this might be maybe a bit of a stupid question, but doesn't that sound a bit question.
To us in our Greek minds it sounds like a claim to exclusivity. I'm the beloved disciple,
Look at me.
I think John would tell you that's the only kind of disciples he has, because he refers to Lazarus at one point as the disciple that Jesus loved. So it's not an exclusive thing he's claiming. He's just saying, I was his beloved disciple. That's the only kind of disciples he has, or beloved disciples.
For sure. So why did John wait such a long time before writing his gospel? I mean, is there a reason why he decided to make it, at the end of his ministry, of his life?
Well, Eusebius says that John had determined that earlier on that he wasn't going to write a gospel. Eusebius doesn't tell us why, but for some reason he decided he wasn't going to. And I think what happens is the church, again, pressure from the church. I mean, imagine you've been sitting with this guy in church, hearing him talk about these things. And you finally just go, you've got to write this down, dictate it to a grandma matus or whatever, a scribe or whatever, however that happened.
That happened.
But I think it's just pressure that he finally gives in. And I think probably he wasn't going to write anything because of his humility.
Yeah.
He's not going to put his name on something like that. He's a very humble person, but you're the last person that knew him. Please write those things.
There's almost like a melancholy in my heart when thinking of John the Gospel, because it's the final, disciple. There's something about that just really plucks at the strings of my heart thinking about that. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Everyone's, like I said, Peter's been dead for 40 years and and his brother, I mean, James and John, the two brothers, James was the first Christian to be killed, disciple to be killed.
Yeah.
John is the last to die. So these brothers are like the bookends of the 12.
Yeah.
James and John. And
it's true. Wow.
I don't know. No, it does. It does. It pulls at your heart.
It's almost like a season that's ending, and the way in which it's ended is in a unique way. I feel like he's like, okay, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it in the way that I feel led to. Yeah. And he just went and did it completely unique.
Well, and you look at the letters, his letters, and you get a feel for his heart, because he'll say things like, I didn't want to write these down. I want to see you face to face. So I haven't written this down yet because I want to see you face to face. And he calls them, his children and that kind of thing. And you see the tenderness of this old, and he's miraculously old. Nobody lives to be, or very few people live to be that old.
Yeah.
I did some homework on that about John's age. Eusebius says he lives to be 100. Clement of Alexandria says he lived into the reign of Trajan, which is 98 to 117.
Yeah.
And so if he lived until 117, then he's like 100 years old, everybody says he is. And people say, well, people didn't live to be that old. He couldn't have lived that old. Well, Hillel lived to be 110.
Yeah.
So people lived to be that old. Exactly. Simeon was old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I wanted to say something now that I can't remember, but that's the thing. The thing for me also is, it's probably going to get back to me now, how John also, that's what I wanted to ask. The fact that, there's this tender side to him, but do you not think there was also a chutzpah kind of side to him as well? Like what he did with James and with James's brother, just, going straight and saying, Lord, let us sit one on the right, one on the left, give this to us. The chutzpah.
Call fire down from heaven and destroy these people.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's partly a function of age. I think by the time you're 100, you don't have much of that left. Although maybe he did.
You're just grateful to be alive.
Right. Well, there's a story also in Eusebius of John going into one of the bathhouses in Ephesus. And there's a heretic named Cerinthes who comes in, Cerinthus. And John jumps up and yells, quick, everyone get out because the roof's going to fall in because this horrible heretic is coming in. And you think, oh, that was pretty gutsy move for a 100-year-old man.
Yeah, I kind of envisioned that as well. So this is a nice question. I like this. What does the uniqueness of John's gospel say about the uniqueness of his relationship with God? Just kind of tying in again with how he understood the heart of God.
Because he had so long to preach and think and pray about who Jesus is and what his relationship with him was like. I think one of the unique things that he understood was that Jesus was the wisdom of God.
Yeah.
I think John understood that in a way that the others didn't understand. But the interesting way is he understands that by virtue of the fact that everything Jesus said was misunderstood. More so than any of the other gospels, every time Jesus says something deeply spiritual, and Jesus usually he waves a red flag. He'll say, "Amen, amen." That's his way of saying, "I'm about to say something really important." He used the word "amen" in a way no one else ever used it. Okay, and in John he'll do that. In the Synoptics he says it once, in John he says it twice, but he'll say something significant. And the next verse indicates that the person he's talking to has no idea. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not that they kind of don't understand it. They way don't understand it.
They completely.
So woman at the well says, Jesus says, I've got water to drink. You'll never be thirsty again. What's she say? Is it because you don't have a bucket that you asked me? You know, Nicodemus, he says.
I just love it. It's quite comical, actually.
It is. It is almost comical. You know, Nicodemus, he says, you must be born again. Nicodemus says, can a man enter his mother's womb a second to be born?
Yeah.
It's not like they kind of don't get it. They way don't get it.
Yeah.
And I think it functions as a literary device, and Jesus becomes more and more misunderstood and lonelier and lonelier until in the end he's all alone.
Mm.
And he's the wisdom of God because he's the word of God. And that's the very first thing. In the beginning was the word.
Yeah.
And John, in that introduction, he lays all the major themes in the first two or three verses that the whole gospel is built on. And that is incredibly elegant. You don't do that unless you've been preaching it for 40 years.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It's
you don't
lived.
Do that if you're Mark talking to Peter. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lived gospel, very much so.
Yeah, I got my numbers here. He quotes the wisdom writings 27 times.
Yeah.
Job, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon.
Yeah.
John quotes the wisdom writing 8 times. John's not interested in the wisdom writings. The Gospel of John. I'm sorry, John's at 27. Luke quotes the wisdom writing seven times.
Seven times.
Matthew quotes the wisdom writing 7 times. Yeah. John quotes it 27 times. Well, he's showing you that Jesus is the wisdom of God, but the Bible's accurate when it doesn't know it's being accurate, because John presents Jesus as the wisdom of God who's misunderstood. Well, if you look at the wisdom writings in the Hebrew Bible, that basically they're not about wisdom. They're about the inadequacy of wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
The book of Job, we say it's a wisdom book. Yeah, it's about the inadequacy of Job's wisdom and his friends' wisdoms,
mm-hmm.
Except for the proverbial wisdom in Proverbs. But like Ecclesiastes, that's the smartest guy in the world, right? The wisest man in the world says, wisdom isn't it. I don't get it. And to me, it's interesting that deep theme that comes from the Hebrew Bible is what John picks up on.
Mm.
Jesus, yeah, he's the wisdom of God. What does that mean? That means nobody understands it. Man's wisdom is inadequate.
That's so true. Yeah, I love that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Kind of finishing off with this, wanted to ask you what your question would be to John if you were to speak to him today.
Yeah, I think I would just say, what was it like being with him? You know, what was it like being with him? And I think you get some of an answer in the letters when he'll say what our hands have touched, what our eyes have seen, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You look back and it's almost like a dream. Did that really happen?
Yeah.
Did he really walk on the water? Did I just dream that? Or I wonder if that's the kind of feeling that he had, but that would be my question. What was it like just walking with him? And I guess if you do your homework and engage with your imagination with this gospel and his letters, you'll get the answer to that, because that's what he's doing.
Yeah.
This is what it was like to be with him. You know, it's frustrating. Nobody ever understood him. One of the things that John does that's unique, I say John's the only gospel that whispers. John is always whispering things to you and explaining things to you. You know, Jesus already had in mind what he was going to do, or his brothers only said this because they didn't believe. Only John does that. And I hear this little old man telling me these stories. And as an aside, there are 57 of them. You know, as an aside, he's explaining why people did things, or why they didn't understand things, or why what Jesus was thinking and that kind of thing. And, I don't know, the humanity. I don't know. I just love that about
it's beautiful.
The Gospel of John.
Very honest. Yeah. It's an honest way of
oh yeah.
Of accounting of narrating the beauty of who Christ was.
Yes.
Michael Carr, thank you so much for your time. Is there anything you would like to leave with the listeners, especially people who, you know, haven't really delved into the cultural context of the Gospels in such a way? Is there anything you'd love to leave with them? Any thoughts, any extra comments you'd like to make?
Well, I think if you've listened to what Shannon and I have talked about and you're excited, you sense our excitement about this person. Okay, I'm 65. I've been a Christian since I was 8. I've known Jesus for a long time. And I find him more interesting, more enigmatic, more mysterious, more frustrating than I at 65. Then he's getting more interesting than me. And so what I would like to say to the people that are listening, if you've sensed a certain excitement that the two of us have about this person, this remarkable person, then we want to encourage you to go to the Gospels and see if this isn't really true. Mm. We're not making this up. We're not making this up.
Amen. Exactly. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for setting aside your time to share with me and with us your insights. It's invaluable and it's blessing to the church and to the people of God. And yeah, may God bless you in everything that you deal with in future, all your new prospects. And as they say in the kingdom of God, we never retire. So I really hope you don't. But
No.
Thank you so much. It's a blessing once again, and may God bless you.
Thank you. Will we ever learn that all to come must stumble? Give me the truth that will affect.